This is Kurt Heisinger, accounting professor at Sierra College and author of Managerial Accounting. This video describes the three steps that are related to implementing activity-based management. The first step that you see here is to identify the activities that are required to complete our products. I'm going to go through an example on the next slide of exactly how we would do this, but for now I'll just give you the broad version. The second step is to determine whether activities are either value-added or non-value-added. Value-added activities add to the product's quality and performance, and non-value-added activities don't. The third step, then, is to continuously improve the value-added activities, those activities that are adding to the product's quality and the product's performance. We want to keep improving on those. Those are things that the customers appreciate. And we want to, so that's the improve part, and then we want to minimize, or if we can, eliminate the non-value-added activities. So let's go to the next slide and we'll take a look at some examples. Let's assume that we operate a pizza restaurant where we cook pizzas to order for our customers. We're going to go through examples here related, simplified, but go through some examples here related to our pizza restaurant. So step one, as we mentioned before in the previous slide, is to identify all of the activities in the production process. Now these aren't clearly all of the activities, but let's just take a look at a few to get an idea of how this works. So we've identified that we take orders by phone. We take orders from our customers by phone and prepare the pizzas based on those orders. On very busy nights, say on Friday night or Saturday night, we often have to put customers on hold because so many customers are calling in their order. Once we get the orders, we place those orders in a queue, meaning we put them in a line for our cooks, and they then prepare those orders as they came in to either our counter or by phone. And then the cooks take those orders and they prepare and bake the pizzas. In the process, sometimes there are some issues with the pizzas and we have to throw those pizzas out. Maybe they're burned, maybe they have the wrong ingredients, maybe we dropped them on the floor by accident, whatever that might be. There are times when we have to throw out bad pizzas. And then lastly, we deliver our cooked pizzas. Maybe we deliver it to their table if they're in the restaurant, or perhaps we have a delivery service where we can deliver the pizzas to their homes. The next step is to take a look at those activities that are value-added, looking at step one, the activities that are there, and those activities that are non-value-added. So we're really looking at which of these activities add to the product's quality and performance, and which of these activities don't. The ones that add to the performance and quality of the product, those are going to be value-added activities, and all the rest will be non-value-added activities. We'll start with the first one, taking orders by phone. That is a value-added activity. That's something that does add to the quality and the performance of the product. Customers appreciate the fact that we do take those orders and that we will customize our pizzas to their order. Second activity that you see here is putting customers on hold. That is a non-value-added activity. It doesn't add to the quality of our product. Customers do not like being put on hold, so that's a non-value-added activity. The third activity you see here is putting the orders in a queue or in a line. Although that may seem like it's the best way to operate, it's a non-value-added activity. And it's a non-value-added activity because it really doesn't add to the performance in any way of the product that we're offering. And remember, the product's not just the tangible pizza, it's the service that we're offering of getting that pizza done quickly. So putting an order in a queue is a non-value-added activity. Preparing and baking the pizzas, that's a value-added activity. Customers, that's why they're calling us, that's why they're coming to us, so that we'll bake those pizzas for them. Throwing out bad pizzas, that's a non-value-added activity. It doesn't really add any quality or performance to our product. And this you might look at and say, well, this is a bit debatable here. If it's a bad pizza, we should throw it out, and that's value-added. But going back, we really shouldn't have those bad pizzas to begin with. So anytime there's waste in the production process, just to broaden this out above and beyond a pizza restaurant, anytime there's waste in the process, in the production process, consider that to be a non-value-added activity. How about delivering cooked pizzas? That is considered a value-added activity. That's why customers come to us, and it definitely adds to the performance and the quality of our products. So here you see we have some value-added activities and we have some non-value-added activities, and that's identifying those as such is step two. Then in step three, we're going to take a look at all of those value-added activities and make sure that we improve upon them. If those are activities that are important to the quality and performance of our product, then we should focus on getting better at those activities because they're appreciated by the customer. The non-value-added activities, we need to make sure we minimize those or eliminate them if at all possible. So let me give you an example real quick. In terms of improving value-added activities, if you look at this first activity here, taking orders by phone, maybe we can set up an automated system so that customers can call in and select the appropriate pizza that they'd like to get, and it's all automated, it's done very quickly, and that might even help us with minimizing the non-value-added activity of putting customers on hold. So again, our goal is to improve value-added activities. Maybe we automate our phone ordering system, as one example, and minimize the non-value-added activities. And maybe by putting into place that automated system, that automated ordering system, we will minimize the number of customers that we have to put on hold. So we're continually striving to improve value-added activities and to minimize the non-value-added activities. So why do organizations use an activity-based management system? Well, we've gone through an example that hopefully starts to illustrate some of the reasons that companies would want to use an activity-based management system, but let's formalize that here. First of all, we want to try to analyze the processes that are involved in the production of our products. The more we know about those processes, the more, going to the second bullet point, we have the ability to improve the efficiency of those processes and therefore the efficiency of our overall operations. And that's something that most companies continually strive for, to improve efficiency. And then lastly, that if we do successfully improve the efficiency of operations, our goal is to improve the profitability of the operations. So this provides three general important reasons that companies implement an activity-based management system.